A group of student environmentalists leaves New York to travel to the Peruvian Amazon in order to save a local tribe from extinction and stop the destruction of part of the Amazon rainforest. Things seem to be going well until their plane crashes and the group finds themselves in the middle of the green hell. Hey guys, this is Afraid, and you're watching The Green Inferno. Let's get into it. It's 9:12 a.m., and a group of environmentalists is on a hunger strike outside the university. The noises wake up the main character, Justine, a cute and nice girl, the daughter of a UN lawyer. Along with her wakes up her best friend, Casey, a very outspoken girl. After passing through a store on their way back to the room, the girls notice the group singing. Justine immediately notices the leader of their group, Alejandro, the guy with the guitar. She considers him attractive and charismatic. Casey, on the other hand, thinks the opposite. During a lecture, students learn that many tribes in Africa remove female genitalia without the latter's consent. They do this for religious reasons. Girls are not considered female unless they remove it. Casey and Justine are disgusted, and Justine in fact reveals that her father is a UN lawyer and they should do something about it. Jonah, a member of the environmental group, hears about Justine's father and immediately writes a message to someone. After class, Jonah in fact spoke to Justine and told her that Alejandro had invited her into the group to talk and get to know everyone. During lunch, Justine spoke to her father about African tribes removing African genitalia. Charles told her that it wasn't all that easy and immediate. They couldn't solve the issue that effortlessly. In the evening, Justine still decides to stop by and meet the environmental group. Alejandro talked about the Peruvian Amazon, the extinction of a local tribe, and the destruction of a part of the Amazon forest threatened by the arrival of bulldozers and armed mercenaries paid by large multinationalists. Justine, at that point, asked what they would do and joked about the hunger strike. Alejandro took it personally and told Justine to leave. The next morning, Justine apologized to Alejandro and told him she wanted to help and make a difference. She wanted to fight for women's rights in Africa, but Alejandro kept telling her she wasn't ready. In reality, Alejandro was just playing psychological games. He would like Justine to come too, more than anything in the world, since her father is a UN lawyer. So, he wants to play it on the principle of consistency studied by Cialdini. Justine, in her own words, says she wants to make a difference and help, so she will want to be coherent with her words and not disappoint others. Alejandro will also use this technique later in the story. Afterward, Alejandro explains the plan to everyone. They will have to go with a plane and walk through the jungle to the place where the bulldozers and armed mercenaries will arrive. They will not bring weapons, only phones to record everything. Being live around the world, the mercenaries would have made a big mistake if they fired, so it should work. Justine tells her friend Casey about the trip she will be taking, but the latter is very skeptical and pessimistic. Instead, Justine tells her father that she is going on an excursion with the other students. Also, she added that they will be safe and that there will be no problems. Yeah, for sure. Later, the group meets Carlos, a wealthy businessman who has invested in Alejandro's plan. Before getting on the plane with everyone, Alejandro told Carlos that Justine was the key to the plan, but she didn't know it yet. After getting off the plane, the group had to take local cabs to a small town where they could eat, rest, and get organized. During lunch, Alejandro reveals to the others that the merchants will be armed and that they might shoot, though impractical. The group began to bumble. At that point, Alejandro stood up, said that no one had forced them to come. In order to stay coherent with their decisions, they all kept quiet and decided to take the plan to the end. The next day, the group heads to the part of the forest where it will all happen. As they travel, they encounter a jaguar. In those places, the jaguar is considered to be the guardian of nature, and he's able to send sinners to hell. Once they got there, they had to dress up as workers in order to sneak in. While the workers were on their lunch break, the group managed to sneak in, and now the plan was to put on masks, tie themselves with chains to the trees that would be cut down, and record everything on camera. Everyone manages to tie themselves as per the plan, but Justine's lock is sabotaged, and she can't lock it. At that point, after an explosion, the group began recording everything and protesting. Soon after, the mercenaries arrived and started pointing guns. They noticed that they were all tied up and couldn't put them on the ground or anything. But wait, not everyone. Justine, not being tied up, is put on her knees and her mask is taken off. At that instant, Alejandro started yelling that Justine's father was a UN lawyer and that they would be finished if they shot. Soon after, the guy pointing the gun at Justine got a phone call and ordered everyone to put their weapons down. After that, the group is taken back to the boats and then to the airplane. In the airplane, everyone was celebrating except Justine, who was about to get a bullet in her head. She realized that she was being used as bait, but Jonah made her realize that thanks to her, they were able to save the forest and the nearby village. Suddenly, as they were flying, the airplane malfunctioned and caught fire. While the airplane was falling, two people fell out of it, after which the airplane crashed completely to the ground. Fortunately, the group came out alive, although full of blood and injuries. Not so lucky were the pilot and the assistant. A group of indigenous people saw the airplane crash and started to approach them. Kara sees one of them and starts to call for help, but is hit full on by an arrow. In the process, the other members were being hit by ferrets that knocked him unconscious. Justine, Alejandro, Lars, Daniel, Samantha, and Amy are taken to the village and surrounded by the natives. They are all red-skinned with black hair. They seem very curious. In fact, they don't stop groping the environmentalists. After being examined one by one by the village leader, the group is locked in a cage. Everyone, except Jonah, he is laid out on a stone platform. After that, the leader of the village cuts out his tongue and eats it raw as it was. After cutting him into pieces, the chieftain drank Jonah's blood and ordered the females of the village to cook Jonah's meat. At that point, the natives turned out to be heinous cannibals. While the natives were all eating lunch together, Amy in the cage began to feel sick and had diarrhea. When she went to the corner to do her business, the natives burst out laughing. Evening came, and the tension in the cage increased. Lars begins to blame Alejandro for everything, who revealed the truth. In reality, they had not stopped the destruction of the Amazon forest, but had delayed it. The company of Carlos, who had invested in this whole plan, would arrive in a few days to start cutting down the trees. The good part is that now the group is known in most of the world, and now they could really change things. Samantha tried to escape through the bars, but was immediately hit by darts that put her to sleep. The next morning, an indigenous boy approached the cage, and Justine began playing the small flute she carried on her neck. After that, the executioner enters the cage, and Justine, Samantha, and Amy are taken from the cage and taken to the village chief. Their genitals are probed through a sharp instrument. Justine is revealed to be a virgin and is taken away for preparation for genital mutilation, while Samantha and Amy are returned to the cage. The survivors decide to attempt to escape. Samantha, taking advantage of a diversion, appears to get to safety. In the meantime, Justine is returned to her cage, half naked and painted white with red dots. While they talk, the children bring the survivors some food, meat with sauce. After eating, Amy realized that the natives had captured and cooked her friend Samantha and that they had eaten her meat. At that moment, Amy, out of disgust, kills herself with a shard of the bowl where she ate. Once dead, the other members of the group realize that the natives would not throw Amy's body away and that she would have ended up like their friends. So, Lars fills Amy's body with marijuana, hoping to stun the cannibals once they consume her flesh. Lars's plan worked. The natives were higher than Snoop Dogg after his fourth joint after breakfast. At this point, one by one, they started to get out of the cage, but when Lars was about to get out, Alejandro hit him with a little dart that paralyzed Lars. When Lars woke up, he was assaulted by the natives, who, still under the effects of the marijuana, began to feel the munchies. Lars tries to run away, but the natives chase him and start to devour him alive and raw. Daniel and Justine, during the journey to the plane, encounter several difficulties, but in the evening, they reach the place where the plane had crashed. The two are speechless at the sight of their friends impaled on wooden stakes, exactly as Vlad Dracula had done with his enemies. While they were looking for a phone, Kara's body fell on Justine, and the natives were close and captured the two. The next day, Justine is being prepped for genital mutilation, while Daniel is suffering tied up on a pole. The natives again paint Justine's body white, while the executioner applies a green substance to Daniel's clothes. The substance seems to attract very large ants that begin to feed on Daniel. The village leader is about to begin the ritual, but is distracted by the news that the lodging crew has arrived. At that point, the natives arm themselves as best they can and head towards the lodging crew. While the others had gone to defend their territories, Justine is held by the little boy whose little flute she played. The little boy helps Justine, and she blows the white substance into the indigenous female's face, which puts her to sleep. Justine sees Daniel hanging from the stake, but it is too late. Daniel was in pain, and his legs were broken. So, the little boy killed him to stop his suffering. Arriving in the middle of the conflict between the natives and the mercenaries, the girl manages to convince them that she is American and stages a fake recording, which convinces the men not to shoot her because they had recognized her as a participant from the first demonstration action. Justine is then rescued by an armed forces helicopter, to which, however, she does not tell of the possibility that Alejandra was alive. The armed forces, in the meantime, have already exterminated most of the tribe. Later, upon returning to New York, Justine is questioned by government and UN officials, and she perjures herself by saying that she was the only survivor of the plane crash, that the natives were friendly to her, and that they helped her before they were exterminated by the armed groups of the oil companies that were doing the lodging. Sometime later, Justine, after waking up from a nightmare, sees outside her campus window a group of activists wearing t-shirts with Alejandro's face in the style of Che Guevara. During a scene in the credits, Alejandro's sister, Lucia, phones Justine, saying that a satellite image showed a person in the jungle who looked like Alejandro, who had been killed by armed militias. Hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, then find out why the Earth might crash into Jupiter in 38 years if we...